I'm Mary Polchaninoff, and welcome to Sure Things. As you can tell, I'm still working from my home base at my dining room table, like most people these days. We're still struggling with the results and the impact of the coronavirus pandemic. But luckily, it looks like we're on the other side with some things opening up throughout our state and other states as well. Today, I'm excited to introduce and invite and have a chat with one of my dear friends. I'll call you a friend, Denise, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
Denise Reynolds. Hi, Denise.
Hi.
Denise, why don't you tell us a bit about, Denise is a hairstylist, and Denise, why don't you tell us about where you're working presently?
I work in Westbrook at Salon Bellevue, and I have worked there for, I think it's been my eighth year there, but mm-hmm. I've been a stylist on the shoreline for 35 years.
So what other experiences have you had? I realize you haven't been in Westbrook that long. So where else, what other places have you been at?
I've been pretty lucky. And right when I got out of hairdressing school, I got my first job in Madison. I worked there for 16, 17 years. And then I had four children and I worked and was a traveling hairdresser for people for quite a few years. And then I got back out there. So I've been in the industry for a long time though.
Did you have to go to school for that? Did you go to school for that, or did you pick that up on your experience?
So to start working as a cosmetologist, I went to school, and we were required for 1,500 hours, and I did that when I was 19 years old, and got my first job at 20, and have been in the industry since then. And I love what I do, and there was never a second that I questioned my career choice, and it's been good.
It's been great. And so I met Denise, I think around 2 years ago. Denise, what do you think?
Yeah, probably around then.
2 years ago.
It's been great.
Yep, it has. And especially with our friendly chats too, because my neighbor, Deb, had kind of introduced us. And we've been enjoying certainly with four children, we have a lot to share. So that's always been fun.
Yeah.
A lot of fun. So I'm wondering, when did you actually close down for the pandemic? When did you close shop?
So the owner decided, I believe it was March 13th, that she actually took initiative before the state shut us down. And, she had a chat with us all and made the decision. It was the right decision. And, you know, she definitely became a leader in that decision making, because salons, you know, before they were enforced, within that week started, and then the health department and the state then forcefully shut us down. And it was pretty hard though for all of us. It was, you know, for me, I can speak for me, for 35 years I was never forced into unemployment. So all of a sudden to not work in an industry that I've loved was really difficult. And, you know, I struggled with it for a few weeks. I really did.
I wondered, besides the fact that, again, knowing you in our time together, to have you not be active, I'm sure was very difficult for one hand. But then how did, I wondered the business aspect of it. How did you fare with not having that business coming in? Did they make any allowance?
Well, it was hard. So we filed for unemployment, and you know, all of a sudden to go down to minuscule dollars to, you know, from making a decent income, and because the supplement from the federal didn't kick in for a while. So, you know, I have been very fortunate that I live with my family, and my mother, who's 86, lives attached to my home. So my whole family, my two adult children and my husband and my mother, everybody pitched in. So I was a fortunate one. I had a network that we could all come in, so I didn't fall behind. But for a lot of people, that wasn't the case. And it was really hard for a lot of hairstylists, especially hairstylists that were raising young kids. And, you know, all of a sudden to have this little unemployment and, you know, it was hard for a lot of people. It was a lot of emotional roller coaster ride for a lot of us.
I bet. I'm sure you kept in close touch with your coworkers during the whole time too. I'm sure it was a good supportive network there too.
It was, and for me, I felt worse for my coworkers because a few of them have young children and, you know, some weren't receiving anything at the time. And it was really trying, but you know, the social networking of us coming together and talking and being on our group chat helped us.
Yeah. I think, and were you Zooming then too? I mean, Zoom has been so amazing.
We did Zoom and it was really, you know, that was important for us. But, you know, again, it just was a whole new world. And in the beginning, it was kind of like we were just trying to figure out what we were doing with our time, you know, and our families. And it was a struggle for all of us.
Was there, and I don't know if this was anything that people were doing as well, was there a way that you kept in touch with clients or did clients reach out or how did that work during the quiet time?
I personally, you know, tried to touch base, especially as we had supposed start dates, you know, when I was reaching out, some people weren't scheduling. I was trying to schedule in hope of, and then it was shut down again. And it just, you know, it was hard. And there was one point, especially the last time it was shut down. I mean, I just bursted into tears out of exhaustion because you just get so excited to get back to work and it was taken away again.
Yeah, I could tell by your emails, and I felt bad about that. Mm-hmm. I could tell that last one about being shut down was really tough.
Yeah, we were ready.
Yeah. Now I know that we're at a different place now, and I know looking ahead they are going to start opening things up for now. But and you must be so excited about that.
Yes, I miss everybody.
Yeah, sure. So what I was also wondering, you know, this idea came up over a family conversation. We were talking about with, you know, things during the pandemic, and even as things open up, there are people that aren't going to go back right away for certain reasons.
Right. Absolutely.
Absolutely. And we've been trying to deal with, especially people that worry about how to keep their hairstyles up and things like that, worried about how to do that care at home. So I wondered about that too. Do you have any tips for the ladies or gentlemen out there when we think about the fact that we might even still be in for a couple more weeks if we're, you know, choosing not to go in a salon?
Right.
Can you share any tips?
Well, first I'm going to say that with my clients personally, I really want them to do what is best for them. Mm-hmm. And if they are nervous, if they are, you know, questioning, to ask the questions, if they are really nervous, then I say, you're not ready to come in yet. And it's okay. So that's the first thing I really want to say, because I think it's important for people to understand that, yes, we're all eager to get back to work, but we also understand the anxiety and the nerves that go with this for the client and for us too. So as far as home hair care, you know, I really feel like for some people, they've had the ability to buy color kits, you know, so they've been able to at least maintain their colors to somewhat from their hairstylist. Mm-hmm. For some people, they have chosen the box way. I guess there's going to be some corrective coloring going on, you know. For some people that don't want to do anything, and like I just had a client text me, help, I have an interview, what do I do? You know, thank God there's a lot of temporary spraying colors and powders that we can use for touch up, you know, even as simple as a little mascara in your front hairline. If, you know, if you're doing a Zoom.
Really?
You can take
that's a very, that's interesting tip there, Denise.
Mm-hmm. Right. So, you know, there's a lot of companies that you can go buy online, but simple mascara, you could go buy a little Maybelline mascara in a light brown and just camouflage it a little bit. Yeah. Or you can buy products such as Wow or whatever. There's so many different lines out there that you can use to camouflage, at least for these Zoom meetings, the front hairline.
Yeah. And so many people are doing these meetings. It's incredible.
Yeah. So, and it works on your brows, and it works, you know, mascara is a wonderful little thing.
That's a good tip for sure.
Yeah.
As a hairstylist in general, the general population is out here trying to make do with whatever, whether it's the box or whatever, and we just hope that it's the right thing. I've heard so many funny stories about what's going on with that. But I appreciate what you're saying as far as everyone should do what they're comfortable with.
Yes.
So you as a hairstylist, when someone comes back and they've been using something off the shelf, you just do some touch up, some repair work, and it's okay?
Well, you know, so hopefully that when somebody has taken a box color that they just did the roots and not brought it through and altered, because it is hard to do your own hair. It's hard for me as a hairstylist to do my own hair. Thank goodness we have each other in the shop to help each other out. And unfortunately, sometimes color grabs on the ends and get a little darker. You know, we're going to all do the best we can, and it may require maybe a few foils to lighten up some pieces. It may require as going as far as we have to use a color remover. You know, it's all going to depend, but because of this new situation and for time allotment, we are allowing extra time as we book. We're not booking like we used to.
Oh, you know, and that's so cool. Yeah, that'll be a change that people notice as well as they get back. What about the other question? Because this one came up again at our family discussion, as well as with some of my extended family and some of my friends. What about those that really need that or that haircut, both male and female? You know, I did try to work on, you know, my husband's hair, which, you know, I don't know, but luckily he's not going anywhere. So it didn't matter.
Right?
Do you have any tips for those people that are feeling like they really want to take those scissors to the hair right now?
Oh, you know, it's hard. I've always, with my own personal clients, I've always tried to teach, if you're going to trim your bangs, I've tried to teach them how to do it, you know, helping them out. Again, you know, I believe that we have to be realistic, especially in this time. So to sit there and say, I'm not going to help, or I'm going to wait till that person gets into the salon, that's not a fair thing. And I don't think that that's right for me as trying to educate my clients. So I hope that my clients are close enough to me that if they want to get the clippers out or they want to get the scissors out, that they text me, hey, I'm too nervous. What do I do? You know, and I'm happy. You know, it's kind of funny because especially for the clipper cuts, I'm always giving them the directions. You know, it's like scooping an ice cream. Make sure don't go straight up. You might take more hair off than you want.
So you do have helpful hints for those at home struggling. That's good.
Yes. Absolutely.
When do you actually, when are, and I'm going to ask you, and I'm just thinking in general, is there a general consensus from the governor saying when salons can open? Is there a date?
June 1st hopefully, you know, June 1st is the date, and we are going to just cross our fingers he doesn't change it again, but we're all planning, the salons are starting to open up that want to. There are some salons who are choosing to postpone that and open it up on a later date, whether it's health concerns, whether it's, you know, it could be that they're living with a family member. I know for myself, with my 86-year-old mother, we are very thankful here. She has a separate apartment. I told her once I start, I won't be seeing her directly as much. We're going to kind of keep our distance a little bit more. Whereas the last 10 weeks, we've been able to all be together. So I think everybody is just doing what they need to do. And hopefully as an industry, we're all supporting each other in our decisions on how we go about you know, but there's definite protocol as we do open up.
Yeah. Oh, good to know. Good to know. How many stations on it normally before March 13th, how many stations do you have in general in your place?
Right. So we have 7 stylists who work in our salon, but as of June 1st, we have all been scattered. We will only have 3 stylists with 3 clients, you know, 1 client each at a time. But we have a big enough square footage that we all have our separate spaces. And so we will not be near each other. And so it's going to be definitely more intimate, which is kind of nice, you know, and we will not be double booking. We will not be, there's just going to be a lot of different protocols. People are going to be required to wear a mask. They're not going to be able to come into the salon to wait. They're going to get a text or a phone call to say, please come in, because everything will be sterilized. We have a list that we will go by to clean, you know, between our brushes, between our combs, between our smocks. And we followed pretty much all of these to begin with, but now we're going to be, you may not recognize us as much. We're going to be wearing face masks and face shield. And, you know, we're going to look a little bit more foreign, yeah. And, you know, hopefully not be too hot. And, you know, we're going to do our best.
Does the, do you get those guidelines? You get certain guidelines from the governor's office that says if you choose to open, you must have these.
Yes.
You do.
So. Yes. There are definite guidelines that we have to, and the health department in each salon's local town will follow through. I believe they all came, the health departments all had to go in and approve everybody's work environment before the salon opened up. I know that they did that in our salon, and making sure that we have all the required equipment, face shields and all that. So, you know, and we're lucky. We actually found face shields that can go on, like full face shields that go on like glasses. So we eliminated that top sealant piece. Yeah. So us who wear glasses, and I'm one of them, less fogging. Because that's one of the concerns, is all the fog up.
Right.
You know, from
So many considerations. So salons aren't doing things like temperature checks, right? They're not doing that.
So I'm not 100% sure if it's mandatory, but I believe a lot of salons are doing temperature checks.
Okay.
You know, when you walk in. Yeah. And I don't know because I was actually on a site last night reading different salons look on that, and you know, everybody has their guidelines on what temperature they're going to accept somebody in. So I'm not quite sure 100% what we are doing on that. I believe I will find out this weekend if there will be definite temperature checks, but I know a lot of salons are doing temperature checks.
And I didn't even realize that's, it's interesting you said that about the range that people might have a range or different temperatures that they say, okay, this is admissible and this isn't. I didn't really.
Again, I'm not quite sure if there's a definitive guideline on that. I will know more about that this weekend.
Yeah. And then, because then you open next week, right? Monday? Yeah. Monday?
Monday is the first, is the shop will open. And again, so our shop is not normally open on Monday, but because we're all scattered now, our shop will be open 7 days a week right now to accommodate us as stylists with our clientele.
Right. And I agree. I think we'll probably see that in quite a few industries, that whole staggering. Because even, you know, my background's education, even when we talk about education and they talk about how will it look to go back, we talk about the staggering. My son and daughter-in-law are here up from where they are from. And they're also talking about the same thing at their workplace in New York City, that they're talking about perhaps some staggered work time whenever anybody gets back in, which is still, of course, very much up in the air at this point.
Right.
But at least this is... a little bit looking at the curve going ahead, the positive view as far as saying that things are opening up and hopefully people will be safe. And it's so that's why today's interview is so interesting to listen to your industry and all the safeguards because as I said, I'm sure there'll be people that one will be lined up and ready to go in, and
right.
then the other people saying, well, maybe I have an elderly parent or I have a little, you know, child at home, and they're going to take their time on that. So that's why I'm
absolutely. I just really feel that everybody should do them and what is comfortable for them, and not feel pressure from other people to, if you're not ready to go to have your hair done, if you're not ready to go in a restaurant, do what's best for you, because then you can live comfortably with yourself. Yeah.
So the other question I have, because again, looking ahead, and we are looking at June and the summer season coming up, I wondered if you knew any of the trends coming up for the summer that you think, as far as hairstyles and treatments go, things that might be trending this summer.
So, you know, I have to be honest with you. We've been so hyper-focused on learning new protocol, and I haven't really dove into that aspect for the summer look, because I mean, it's been consuming with just getting back into the salon and just tackling. Everybody just wants to feel fresh with themselves where they are. So I don't know how much change, but I will say I was able and fortunate that I have wonderful daughter-in-laws and a daughter that I got to play and do their colors and keep up with, you know, the balayage and all that. So it was a lot of fun this past week. And I was like, oh my gosh, we're having family hair day. Yay. And it felt good to refresh on it.
Oh, that's, you know, I love your energy, you know, Denise. Mm-hmm. That's why I was so excited that you came into chat, because I was thinking your energy is addictive and it just, it's great.
Well,
and
I tell you,
positive.
Thank you. I tell you, though, I did say to them all, I go, you are all so lucky. You know how many people are jealous?
Oh, I agree, because I'm certainly in that lineup. And so I was trying to get my daughter-in-law to come on, too, because I thought maybe she'd come out and ask some questions. But everybody's busy with working from home. So that's something that they have to take care of as well.
Absolutely. But, well, I can't wait to get back to work, so.
Did your it sounds like you've had quite a bit of communication within your staff and your boss and everything.
Absolutely.
That's great. So
it's been very, very tight knit with all of us in communication.
Right. Excellent. It sounds like you're all ready to go. And I guess with Connecticut, you know, phase one really underway and phase two coming in June, then, you know, I guess we really are, as long as we're being safe and come in with our masks into our places and keep our distance, it sounds like it's a positive viewpoint from moving ahead, I hope.
So absolutely. And I can just speak for our salon, we're ready.
You're ready, yeah.
Ready. Yeah. We absolutely are ready. You know,
So I want to thank you, Denise, for joining us today.
Thank you for inviting me.
I'm so excited, and
it was fun to dress up, even though you can't see what I'm wearing. It was fun because I've lived in sweatpants for 10 weeks, you know, and all that. So that was a lot of fun to do my makeup and hair.
It's been a challenge for us all. So once again, thank you. And I do hope to see you soon. I just want to say thank you. And thanks everybody else for also tuning in to Sure Things. Bye, Denise.
Bye, Mary.
Take care.